every single monument and historic building. It's not an easy exercise. I know the principal commissioner for IT, I know the quarterly, some of you must have read it. It always contains a breast cancer survivor, it contains a woman of substance, it features about something else. The lady on the left is my mother, the lady on the right of me is Ananda Shankar Jain, who's my patient, a Padma Shri awardee and a very accomplished dancer. And she in fact heads the breast cancer support group that we have, where we connect not just breast cancers. If a lady with young, early breast cancer in her 20s is diagnosed, we connect women in their 20s with early breast cancer. If a lady in her 40s is diagnosed with advanced breast cancer, we connect with a lady in their 40s who has already been treated for breast cancer. So that when we connect women of similar ages, when we connect women of similar stages, they are able to connect with each other better. And I think this is a foundation that is really being spearheaded by Ananda Shankar Jain. Over the past 10 years, I've taken every opportunity to empower people at more than 1,000 organizations. We were featured, invited. Never a rupee was spent in paid advertisements. Always invited talks in newspapers. And we were featured as recently as last 2 weeks ago in New York Times as well. My opinion was taken. So when we started doing initiatives like this, we caught national and international attention. The first high-profile visitor who came and visited us was Jeannie Mulford, who was the wife of the then US ambassador who had a mastectomy. And she chose to come to Hyderabad for a checkup. And she has gone back to the US and she's our biggest advocate in the US. Yes. This is the Prasad's IMAX in pink. The second component of my talk is on screening. We know that early detection of breast cancer can arrest disease progression and reduce breast cancer deaths. And we want to see breast cancers from a palpable stage to an impalpable stage through screening. That is the palpable breast cancer on that side and the impalpable on the other side. I won't go into the randomized trials, but several randomized breast cancer we know can prevent deaths because it is not a systemic disease at the very outset. And can we introduce a population-based breast cancer screening in this country using mammography? We can't. So what did I do? I started initiating opportunistic. So what I did was, we hired a mobile bus and basically we initiated this soon after I returned in October 2007. And key centers were identified even whilst I was in the UK. We went to the secretariat, we went to the governor's bungalow, we went to the various offices and we went around with this bus to create awareness and conduct a mammography, which was done by a radiographer and a radiologist. Our aim was to educate, be sure. We had mammograms reported by three people. One, by our own radiologist. Two, by me, because I also read and report mammograms. And three, by a radiologist from a world-renowned center in the UK, that is the Jarvis and St. George's Screening Center. Similarly, for mammography, which is done by a radiographer, the first 950 mammograms were quality assured. That is, it was basically reassured and quality assured by the radiologist and radiographer from the UK. And therefore, within that 3 month period, we had a huge learning experience. 950 women were screened. We picked up 4 impalpable breast cancers and cancers like this, very small in women who had no symptoms, and those who had suspicious microcalcifications. We were the first to introduce stereotactic core biopsies. Normally when you have microcalcifications, one of the management approaches is to do a wire-guided surgery. But we introduced stereotactic core biopsy, which can tell you within 5 minutes whether there's a cancer or not. So when you pick up a cancer which is so small, how do you remove it? We do wire-guided surgeries, and basically I've been trained to put in my own wires, not just to rely on a radiologist, because it's a very important thing for a surgeon to know where the wire is going. We were also able to introduce oncoplastic breast surgery, which is not breast surgery after reconstruction, after mastectomy, but this is oncoplastic breast surgery, is reshaping of the breast after doing a breast conservation so that you're able to give good aesthetic outcome to the lady. There's no point in creating a big defect and saying that you have done a breast conserving surgery, and oncoplastic breast surgery has been introduced. So the opportunistic breast screening over the past decade not only created awareness, but we were able to introduce the concept of opportunistic screening, where people were able to come to the press center confidently, without hesitating, without being shy, without it being a taboo, and get themselves a mammogram. But, ladies and gentlemen, can this be applied in the rural parts of our country? Can what the Pink Ribbon campaign, if I go and talk in villages, will they accept it? The answer is no, they are not going to accept it. But the real question is mammography a viable screening tool in our country as a population-based setting? In our country, the evidence-based guidelines that apply to a high-resource country like the United States or United Kingdom cannot be applied in our country. And breast screening by way of mammography is not a viable screening tool. One, huge costs. We can't afford mammography machines. Two, I'm sorry to say, huge variation in mammographic reporting, because we don't have breast radiologists who see mammograms day in and day out. It's not just picking up a bundle of cancer, we have to pick up subtle changes on the mammogram. And in our country, ladies and gentlemen, 87% of our population are under the age of 50. Only 30% are over the age of 50. So screening mammography doesn't really work under the age of 50. And for these three reasons, screening, population-based screening by way of mammography doesn't work. I'm not saying screening won't work. If my mother is 50 and if I have to ensure she gets early detection, I must ensure that she gets a mammogram done. Please don't get me wrong. I'm talking about community-based, population-based screening mammography. So is there a solution? Yes, there is a solution. I knew that breast self-examination is not going to be effective. And I also knew that we have our government employees, healthcare workers, who work very closely with these women in the villages, because I went and spent time in these villages. I even foolishly tried to create a Pink Ribbon campaign there also. Having failed, I recognized that there are these healthcare workers who are the key people, because we can initiate clinical breast examination. Screening by way of clinical breast examination has circumstantial evidence that it works in low and middle resource countries. So therefore, we try to introduce that, because it is simple, it is inexpensive, it helps to downsize the tumor, and it's an excellent opportunity for the healthcare worker to empower the lady who is in the village, about the importance of early detection of cancer. So what I did was, in 2012, I approached the Chief Minister and I said, look, we can partner with you, we can train your healthcare workers to perform clinical breast exam, and we can implement this in the community. If we do this, we will ensure that breast cancer is detected early. And thankfully, the Chief Minister agreed. The Chief Secretary of the day at that time was a lady, Minnie Matthew, and she readily agreed and she gave unwavering support to this initiative. We had the District Collector, the Health Secretary, and everybody in the government machinery. We started this off as a pilot project, and when KCR took over as Chief Minister, within 1 month of his taking over, I went and gave a PowerPoint presentation. He sat through the presentation. Unlike other Chief Ministers, he didn't say, okay, my secretary will see this. He waited, he saw my letter, he read my letter for 10 minutes. He allowed me to present this for 15 minutes uninterrupted. And then he said, our government will support you. And therefore, we launched the screening program in Telangana. And here is the Health Secretary launching the screening program. And soon after Telangana was launched, I approached the Chief Minister of Andhra Pradesh, who again readily agreed, and we had the current Vice President of India, who was then the Honorable Minister at that time, Central Minister, who launched this campaign. So what we have done is, we have created audiovisual aids and booklets about how to examine and also how to create awareness in Telugu. And these booklets took 6 months to prepare, the audiovisual aids as well. And what we did is, we trained the healthcare workers in Hyderabad and in all the districts. And the protocol was, they would go and examine women between the ages of 35 and 65. If the screening assessment is normal, they would come back and see them in 2 years' time. If the screening assessment is abnormal, they would be reported to a district health official who would take it forward with the FNAC, bone biopsy, or whatever it is. And then, because cancer is covered by our Aarogya Sree, all these patients get treated under the Aarogya Sree scheme. This is a sample of the healthcare workers that you see who got trained by us in different segments in different parts of the country. And this is a typical village setting. This is a community-based healthcare worker. She has all these women sitting in the community hall. She's educating them. She's showing them the audiovisual aids.
And then after that, she takes them to their home, their own homes, and examines them. And there's a protocol where they write down their findings and report it back. And I had unrestricted access to the secretariat once a week, where I'm able to interact with all these healthcare workers in different parts to clarify their doubts, whether they need any assistance, and any assistance was required, we were able to provide. Over the past 5 years, we've seen more than 200,000 underprivileged women spread across 4,000 villages in 15 districts of Telangana and Andhra Pradesh. We were able to pick up 356 cancers, and all these cancers are undergoing Aarogyasri treatment, and I don't get involved at all in the Aarogyasri treatment, because on a matter of principle, when our foundation is doing this, I said that KIMS will not be a referral base. I will not be seeing any of these patients because I don't want any bias. So the screening program in the Telugu states did make a national impact. After being conferred the Padma Award, once again I wrote to the Prime Minister. In fact, when he came and patted on my back during the Padma Award ceremony, I said, can this be implemented in the country? He said, yes. He said, write to me. I wrote to him. Within 48 hours, he wrote back to me, and he put me in touch with the Union Health Secretary, and I was incorporated into a central committee which looked into screening not only for breast, but breast, cervical and oral cancers. And I can proudly say that because of the initiative that we have taken here, and after the letter that I have written, now breast cancer screening is a national program with 5,000 crores earmarked, and 5 districts in every state are going to be done. At the moment, training the healthcare workers is happening, and I am very proud to say also that the audiovisual aids that we have used in Telangana and Andhra Pradesh is being used nationwide, converted into, translated into Hindi, and it is being done. Union Health Secretary, who invited me to give a presentation after the Prime Minister's letter. And so, ladies and gentlemen, in our country, there needs to be a paradigm shift as far as community-based screening is concerned. The traditional emphasis on population-based screening mammography, the new emphasis has to be screening by way of clinical breast examination. So the tools at hand, we have multiple tools, but I won't go any further into this. But I would like to highlight this during the Kallar Pandalaya oration, which I am going to be giving later on in the year, on the role of blood test to detect breast cancer, and on the role of piezoelectric current to be able to pick up breast cancer. These are all innovative modalities to pick up breast cancer, which is far superior than clinical breast examination, easier to implement, and far, far cheaper than cheaper than screening mammography. So, before I'm taken away, Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, the rising incidence and mortality coupled with age shift and advanced presentation is a cause for great concern. A nationwide strategy by individuals, hospitals, NGOs in partnership with the Government of India can significantly reduce mortality of breast cancer. And the advocacy over the past decade has transformed breast cancer from a taboo, a closet issue, to a much commonly discussed issue. And screening, you know, significantly reduces risk of advanced disease and reduces mortality. And it's important that that healthcare professionals appreciate the overwhelming weight of this evidence in support of screening. In India, clinical breast examination is practical, effective and pragmatic screening tool. And we should not forget the importance of opportunistic screening mammogram, where we can gift our women folk a screening mammogram once a year from the age of 40. And disruptive technologies are certainly in waiting. And finally, I'd like to say that from when I graduated 27 years ago, I've come a long way. My mother's setback in the form of breast cancer was the driving force for me to return to my motherland and to my parents. With focus, determination and hard work, alongside friends, colleagues and the Government of India, I certainly have been able to make a meaningful difference. And certainly, returning to my mother land and to my parents, who are my God-sent messengers, has been a real God-sent opportunity for me, because I believe that there's no place on earth sweeter than home, home sweet home. And my heart beats for early detection of breast cancer. And I cannot thank enough the Executive Committee of Telangana State Chapter for giving me this distinct honor of delivering this most prestigious oration named after late Dr. A.K. Charigar. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Raghu, for your wonderful work. And on behalf of all the delegates and all the members who are actually very shortly, now we are going to felicitate you.
Yadav will be introducing Dr. G.P. Ramaya oration, and we have our chairpersons Dr. P. Rappa, our chairman, and Dr. Jagdishwar Gaur and Dr. Ramesh Ramaya.
It's an honor to introduce Dr. G.P. Ramaya. His full name is Gujarala Pattabhi Ramaya, was born September 15, 1913, at Vardhanpet, Varangal district. He did his schooling in Vardhanpet and later moved on to do his undergraduation at Aligarh Muslim University. After finishing his education at Aligarh Muslim University, he did his surgery and got gold medal in anatomy and surgery at both as an outgoing student. He served as a professor of surgery and chief surgeon in both Usmania and Gandhi University's hospitals, and also served as the principal of the Gandhi Medical College. His main interest was urology, and apart from gastrointestinal surgery, he had gone an immense popularity in Telangana as a surgeon and considered as a living legend. He was the personal surgeon for the Nizam of Hyderabad. Dr. G.P. Ramaya served in the Nizam's Majestic Navy Army in the Second World War and deputed to England by the Nizam by his scholarship, and learned urology in UK. After FRCS, he worked for St. Peter's Institute of Urology in London and specialized in urology. On return to India in 1953, he joined as the chief medical officer in Nanded and later shifted to Usmania Medical College as the resident medical officer. He served as professor of surgery and chief surgeon of both Usmania and Gandhi University hospitals. He was also principal. As I already told you, he was the chief surgeon to the Nizam. He has two sons, Dr. Ramesh Ramaya, real urologist. It's incidental that Ramesh is not doing well today, so he couldn't join us. He is sick. And his other brother, Dr. Pradeep Ramaya, is an anesthetist and also a medical informatics surgeon. His grandson, Dr. Tarun Ramaya, is a cardiologist in USA, and Dr. Akila Ramaya, gastroenterologist in USA, are settled in various countries along the globe. This is my pleasure to introduce Dr. G.P. Ramaya, a very renowned surgeon, and he was also my father's teacher.
It's an honor to introduce my teacher, Professor Jay Kumar sir, one of the best surgical oncologists of India as of today, and a robotic cancer surgeon. He is presently the Vice Chancellor of Europa University, and he was ex-director of Kidwai Memorial Institute of Oncology, the second institute in India to view MC surgical oncology. Those days, 20 years back, there were only two seats per year, and it was like a jungle, the fight for the MCL seat. Now a lot of seats are there. And he was the HOD and director of Kidwai Memorial Institute of Oncology. And he's an inspiration to us. He has come now today, he goes around and he's a vice chancellor. He has brought the latest robot in the India, and he's still an inspiration to students and rise like a phoenix. And he used to overcome all the difficulties, and he has risen to the toughest past. All students should learn from him how he worked very hard without any backup, without any support. He is my inspiration and he is my guru, and he is a person from whom I learned how to tackle tough things and learn subject and surgery also. And he got his robo in his university. I was honored to have done so many workshops with him. And this was one of his first as an assistant professor way back 18 years back when I was a registrar in surgical oncology. And he has an aptitude for, and he knows all the randomized control trials in oncology. You name him, he will just tell the trial. And in the rounds, he used to throw patients, and students used to fear him. But off the hospital, he used to be a very friendly guy, friendly person. And he's His CV is very, very, very long, and I think so many international papers. But I think that is the introduction I would like to give of you, a director, a teacher, a good husband, and a father to only one daughter, and a teacher for all of us and for many, many, many students. And he still guides his assistants to learn robotic surgery. He himself tells them, come on, go and do surgeries. Come on, go and robotic surgeries. Ladies and gentlemen, I introduce Professor Vijay Kumar to you. His CV is very, very long, and you should know him as a person. As a person, as a teacher, as a father. Please come over, guys.
Very good morning to all of you. Respected chairpersons, the organizing committee of today's conference, my dear senior colleagues, friends, ladies and gentlemen. It has been a great honor to be here. I have been visiting this city only as an NCH examiner for those many university. And today, I have been invited as narrator, for which I am thankful to everyone responsible, and especially Dr. Jagdishwar Gowd, who was my old student. Maybe he wanted to put me in a face, and thereby giving me and him an opportunity to teach each other. That's how we grew. And Dr. Dilip Gode was talking about the mentorship. I was only thinking of those days at least. The mentees were also good and mentors are also good. Today I sincerely feel mentees are also not that good, mentors are definitely not good. And that is where I think we'll have to change. And mentors should take the responsibility of a mentor, and the mentees should understand their role too. Before I start this, a word about Raghu's talk before me. It was more of an emotional roller coaster for many of the cancer-related people, particularly me as a cancer surgeon of about 35 years in standing. What I could not achieve in the state of Karnataka, which he could achieve nationally. My compliments to him. Not only I am trying to push the Karnataka government to certain extent that the Asha and Anganwadi workers and all are getting praying for them. I like to prove a star, but I have to do an impact analysis thanks to Tata Trust, which helped me to do the impact analysis, how far and how much and how well the Asha and Anganwadi workers can be taken into consideration. And thereby we can propose, even to the rural India, the screening and the early detection part. But anyway, I have taken the lead for this whole lecture. I'm sure I am inviting him to see and guide what best can be done in our institute. Thank you, Dr. Raghu, to be here. Me being a simple teacher, I have chosen a topic which will be useful for my colleagues and my students. And also, it will give us, me, an opportunity to go through. We all know in cancer rectum where we are. Where we are, and we also know what is happening to the cancer rectum today. It's one of the most cruel cancers, if you ask me, giving you a permanent stoma through which the fecal matter comes out, nobody likes in this world. And added to that, when you do the surgery of the rectum, what leaves behind is not only a stoma, but sexual dysfunction and the urinary bladder dysfunction. And added to all this, there is a chance of pregnancy always, because the physics, biology is like that. This is how this cancer rectum has started. And we are standing today in an era where we are talking about a cure, no doubt. But when we have traveled so long, at least people like me, some of my colleagues who are of my age and seniors, they know how much struggle we have gone through to reach a stage today where we are talking about a cure. We'll quickly go through before talking about what is happening today, what has happened earlier, what is our past. Younger colleagues may not even know that for the cancer rectum, what was offered was only a perineal resection. Just perineal resection, which used to result in mortality because of the peritonitis, with the high recurrence rates and because of the improper access. The 95% rate was the recurrence rate those days, resulting in mortality. One Dr. Miles in Garden Hospital for Retinal Diseases just analyzed his own data of 12 years where 57 perineal resections are done and 95% of them recurred within 6 months. And the postmortem examination suggested the recurrence were in the pelvic peritoneum, mesocolon, and iliac nodes. Thereby, he created the first time in the history of adding a laparotomy to the perineal resection, thereby coining the word abdominal perineal resection. No doubt, this was an addition to the surgery, but the recurrence rate was in the range of 90%. It's not reduced to 2% or 5% as we are seeing today. It is just 90%. Only thing what had happened was the time to recurrence. And definitely the time to recurrence was high and they lived longer to get a recurrence and die of it. But because of the longevity and the time to recurrence was high, the APR, abdominal perineal resection, became the gold standard. The Miles way of doing APR, if you look at it, he used the word abdominal anus for what today we are talking about, colostomy, wherein the whole pelvic colon was removed, the mesocolon was removed, and the lymph nodes were removed, and the perineal resection was done as wide as possible. But when you start moving beyond Miles, then came one Lloyd Davis who introduced a single stage procedure and called it as the team approach, and then the problem of stoma continued. One gentleman asked a question, why stoma for all rectal cancers? Why not avoid that? Then he started doing the limited resections, what today we call it as anterior resection, wherein stoma is not created and they were able to pass motion per naturalis, and it was the treatment of choice for upper and midrectum. But the demand of local recurrence continued, 30 to 45% recurrence rate. So they started having different questions. Is the surgery adequate? Is the technique validated? Whether the competency of the surgeon is resulting in that, and is there a need for adjuvant treatment? This is how we started, and we have now two extensions to this story. One is extension surgery, that is TME, which we will be talking. Then addition to it would be the radiotherapy. That is how in 1982, Mr. Higgs from UK introduced the concept of mesorectum, which is the covering of fat and tissue around the rectum, which is enveloped by a facial layer, and that forms the embryological basis of starting this treatment. This is how it looks. Pelvic alveolar in rough shape is here. This is the rectum. This is the mesorectum around which this fascia, two-layered fascia is there. And this layer is called as visceral layer, and this layer is called as the parietal layer. And in between goes the plate. That is how he started. And the principles of mesorectal excision include direct visualization and good light, and the perimesorectal poly plate. That is the most important one, with a sharp dissection, and the most importantly, this is a pathology-oriented surgery. It's a specimen-oriented surgery, and that's where it's scored over other places. Then what is this MRE? The mesorectal excision, what is it? It is an excision of the rectum with its blood vessels around and lymph nodes within the intact visceral fascia. What are the types of MRE? Two types are there. One up to the liver trachea, if you go and remove the mesorectum, it's called as total mesorectal excision. And we limit it only for 4 centimeters below the tumor, it's called as Y or partial mesorectal excision. The surgical anatomy of the mesorectum, as I said, is important. The visceral layer and the parietal fascia are there, and in between is the loose areola tissue through which you go. As we start going in the retrorectal space, we will get at the level of S4 a dense condensation of this fascia called rectosacral ligament. We all surgeons, we are all trained, young. We used to do the so-called Miles operations. At this point, we know when you try to go away, we will shear the vessels and land in devastating blood loss. That is the pre-sacral plexus of vessels will be in chew. And the only way in those days would be back and come. I am very, very sure the people who are of my age and seniors here would remember at least a couple of cases which they would have gone through. Having seen this problem, what we used to do and many of the surgeons do in that place is, instead of going away, you go towards the rectum, thereby coning down occurs to avoid the bleeding, but you go close to the rectum, leaving a probably microscopic disease. And this is what the basis of local treatment surface. In a open surgery, this is how it looks. I don't know how well it sees there. This is the pre-sacral area. And this is what we are talking about. This is the sympathetic lobe, the hypogastric, superior hypogastric plexus. Then this is the distal and it added in this area additional pelvic nerves and make it inferior hypogastric plexus. Why we have to say? We all know. Once the autonomic blood nerve supply is injured, what results is the sexual dysfunction as well as the bladder dysfunction. And that is why this has to be seen. And this is how it looked in the open surgeries. So if you quickly see how the Miles and Peel's difference is, the Miles is to be blank one with fingers, and you all know in the open era, open surgical era, the moment you put your hand into the pelvis, you are blind. And most of the time surgery is done by tactile sensation rather than by visual sensation. Whereas today, with advent of long instruments and longer cartridge tips, we are doing under visualization and a sharp dissection. And what results should be a shiny baby's bottom. The specimen should look like a shiny baby's bottom, and then that is possible only when you have a facial integrity. This is how it should look. This is how it should look. This is a bad surgery where the fascia has already gone inside, and so the blood vessels, the lymphatics, the fat, everything is being thrown out, and that will result in a poor recurrence rate. The effect of TME was studied. The Heels came out with the TME has become the standard of treatment later. At the same period of time, the radiotherapy was also introduced in the management of rectum as an adjuvant. There are trials both in the pre-TME era and post-TME era to support saying the adjuvant treatment improves the local control. And we are in the era of multimodal treatment where surgery and radiotherapy and also the chemotherapy has been introduced as either in the adjuvant setting or in the concurrent setting as we go on to see. But when you look at the abdominal perineal resection as it stands today with the TME added, we have a mortality of 22%, but morbidity is around 30%. But it stands to be in T1, it looks as though we are overdoing it. And in T3, T4, in spite of being such a major surgery, the fatal recurrences are high. That is where we have started moving towards what to be done for the best. The first one is, when we are thinking it is an overkill, we have to move and see what will be done to save the sphincters. To save the sphincter, two things can be done. One, you can do a local excision. The other can be a segmental excision. If you are looking at local excision, we are looking at transcendental, the conventional endoscopy. Or the posterior golden days, where Krasny and the apnesis, nobody does now. And the segmental resections where when you do anti-resection and ultra-loaded anti-resection scheme. And we have even gone to the extent of doing polar and anastomosis to save the sphincters. This is possible only when the location of the tumor is good enough for us to perform such procedures. The distal margin is important and the extent of TME, and more importantly now it has become done more and more frequently because of the advent of the staplers. We'll quickly see what local excision we are talking about. The local excision we are talking about is a full thickness, 1 cm margin, and the defect is closed, and this is possible only when the disease is localized. What is the rash name? Because of the near normal anal continence, we'll get no colostrum. And of course, in a T1, the mortality and morbidity is less. But can it be done in all cases? Answer is no. It can be done only when the complete excision is amenable and accessible. So when it is to be made amenable, it has to be a less than 3 cm diameter tumor, and where you can easily approach to transanally and remove it with the good clear margins. And that is possible today with only T1. How do you assess T1? Earlier days we did not have an opportunity to assess whether it is T1 or not. With a digital examination, we can only see it's mobile, fixed or colored. Today with the transrectal ultrasound, we are able to assess properly and say whether this is T1 or otherwise. Only for a T1 disease, that is mucosa and submucosa, disease is confined to that, we are able to offer this with good results. But while reaching these goals, what has happened is a lot of other things have come into the picture about surgery. One is the multimodal equipment, I said. Next is the laparoscope. Laparoscopy. I am sure everybody who is practicing surgery today is doing laparoscopy for some form or the other, for some disease or the other. I am talking about oncological control. When laparoscopy came, they were talking about the reduced hospital stay, analgesia, really as immune suppression. But at that time, the learning curve was more, and the oncological adequacy was questioned, and port site recurrences were a demon, and the lymph node harvest and the safety was questioned. To answer that, there are a lot of trials came out from UK, Europe and others. And this one important trial which always I like to quote for different reasons. One, in 2005 the MRC trial came out saying that laparoscopy is inferior. Hopefully that many of us have not read it or did not want to follow. Because they said in 2007 it is good enough. And in 2013 they said laparoscopy is a preferred approach. By the same group coming out and saying that in 2013. Hopefully we didn't wait for that, and in India at least we all continue to do rectal surgeries from much before 2000. If you look at this, this for the sake of youngsters, for a different reason I am showing this. I will show why I am talking this. I know the visibility will be poor, and I want you to know that visibility will be poor, because when we all started, it was a single chip camera. This is the single chip camera I am trying my first ever laparoscopic APR. You can see the instrumentation there, the rigid 10mm instruments. I am struggling and the instrument is also struggling. This was the scenario when we all started. Why I said it today, for the sake of extras means, please understand, you wait for things to settle and you want to get the best of the time without any constraint and restraint, then only you'll start. In a joke like way, I have to tell you, you will be like sitting like Ganesha waiting for your wife to come. You will never get one. You will have to quickly adapt with what we have, prove a point to our administrators that this is possible. Thereby, they will get convinced and get us what today we are enjoying, the three-chip, high-definition cameras, etc. This was not available. But we moved on to do that, so that to prove a point to everyone and see the way we will be struggling here, with all. See the way the knotting process goes on and the inferior epigastric artery. Yes, it is me. I am struggling because it is the first ever laparoscopic APR I am doing. And I am trying to show this again to the youngsters to say everywhere you will have to have a beginning, and in the beginning you can't be mastering the technique you have to go through. But today, the scene has changed. We have gone long way. And the surgical outcomes of the laparoscopy, as I said, was proved to be superior and better. But in the laparoscopy, I was dependent on that another person, particularly in a teaching institution, he moves, he changes. So he is the camera person who has to be very steady, and he has to remember what I do, what I want to do. And he was my eye, but I have to keep on telling him. Whereas this one thing, and then improved dexterity and 10 times improved magnification and good ergonomics in our robotics, which we started doing last 2 years, I am doing it.
that title.
This was done as a robotic low and perception. There was a workshop conducted by us at the Kanapa University. Of course, two of your colleagues were there to demonstrate. One was Dr. Jagdish Gaur for Easy Vegas and Dr. Subramanian Rao for colon. And this is for rectum. You can see the way how well it is going on. That is the nerve. That is the nerve, autonomic nerve. Here we are trying to dissect the what is holding there by the robotic arm is the inferior vein that is somewhere there in the PJ flexion or put the gas piece. So we are going around. And once you do that, you are able to see that much, much better. And you can see this now. That is the ureter, that's the gonadal vessel, that's the common iliac where it crosses. Once that part of the left colon is done and we are moving towards the recta and see the way the structures are opening up, and this is possible because of the neurobrotonium, of course, and the magnification makes life much, much more simpler, and people, older ladies can sit and operate nicely. And this is what I was talking about, the so-called baby's bottom, where it is shiny, not transgressing anything. The anterior part of it, this is the bladder, this is the rectum, we are mobilizing, you can see now better, this is the rectum, this is the bladder, and prostate, we are moving towards doing the anterior part, anterior section, you can just see, yes, that is the, and once the endocentrous cuts, you can see the upper. The specimen will come in our hands, and the whether the robotic colorectal surgery can come as a change, somebody asked, for that a beautiful answer came from one of my colleagues. When the benefits are obvious for all to see, when surgery is made safer for the patient, and when the procedure is made easier for the surgeon, everybody will accept it. But the only problem today for me to do it for all patients is concerned regarding caste. Caste is one thing which is coming in the way of doing it for everybody. But I can proudly say that in the university where I am working, 80% of the patient, cancer patients are treated free of caste. They come from the below part line, and including robo, we do it free. And that is probably not possible for everyone, but we are making an attempt to do it free for the patients under some scheme or another. As RMST scheme in Telangana and Andhra, we have got a scheme called as Arogya, watched by RMST, and under which we do all these programs. Having seen the limited resections and the APR, is there a need for doing at this day about extended operations? That is total pelvic excentration, posterior excentration, and in places where sacrectomy can be added. The answer is yes. We have to do in some places where in a specified selected groups because the disease is advanced. Once the disease is advanced, you can't be playing the same thing. You can see that this is there. We are removed going to the, this is the bad ureter all around. This is the ureter. These are the vessels, iliac vessels. These are the iliac vessels and the catheter of the rectum. These are not the resection is possible. Required in this case. I'll show you the specimen, then you will know what I'm talking about. That the whole of the pelvic rectum is removed, the uterus, the genitals are removed, the sigmoid is removed, rectum is removed. Why we have done this? I'll quickly show you the specimen. That will tell you why we have done this surgery. The pelvic area, because R0 resection, if we can achieve the R0 resection, we have to remove completely everything in the uterus, and that is the cervix, this is the rectum, and this is the sigmoid. Even today, there is a rule for extended resections, and we have to do them when they come to extremity 2, it is either skin sparing, sorry, the splinter space saving procedure, and for where you cannot save the splinter, you do the APR. And in the T3-T4, of course, today we give a preoperative treatment and then take for surgery in the form of controlled RTCT. Most of my work in 31 years have been done in KMU, this is the standard senior U. I am there in the university now for only 3 years, and my robo worker standard after my moving to university. university, no doubt. But I have left behind, for even the government institute like Hindwai, I got a robo, and they are doing a good work there also. So this is the scenario. About 300 cases you see, and 40% of them will go for APR, and 40% will go for LAR, and of course, 50% even today turned out to be enough. Is there a role for metastatic disease? If you ask in general, they would have answered no. Whereas in colorectal cancer, the answer is yes. The 15-25% of them present with presentation, and 25% will develop in 3 years. And hepatic resection is currently the only potentially curative therapy for these patients. In a select group where it is confined to one site, then 4 centimeter size, etc., we are doing a resection, if necessary, both together or at a staged manner. But at the end of the day, metastatic disease in liver is treated surgically along with the primary. The line about multimodal treatment. Although this is a surgical group, I have covered mostly surgery. Please do not go with the idea the cancer rectum today is treated only with surgery. It is a part of the treatment and probably the most important part of the treatment. But we have got radiotherapy as a given preoperatively or post operatively depending on the location and the stage. And chemotherapy is given in the form of alpha-35FU, oxaliplatin and leucovorin. And the early disease, we use it as adjuvant. In the local advances, we use it as concurrent RTCT and metastatic disease, chemotherapy or transarterial chemoembolization. Apart from this, there is a targeted therapy which has come for the cases where it is positive in a metastatic setting. Bevacizumab is also used in cancer of the rectum. Today, from the days of no cure, from the days of 95% recurrence rate, today we have moved in the era of cure, either with this limited resections or with extended resections, along with the help of chemo and radiotherapy, we are able to contain this disease very successfully. And today, we are moving towards the individualized treatment. Hopefully, we will be able to control at the same time give a much better quality of life than what we given today to my patients. And I am thankful to all of you for listening to me, and I am thankful to the organizers for giving me an opportunity. I thought I will give an overview of what we have been doing in cancer rectum and what the scene has changed, particularly keeping the post-graduate student in my mind. The whole talk has been preferred. I once again thank Dr. Jagdishwar Gowd and his team for giving me an opportunity. Thank you.
Surgeons will pretty much say the same thing about laparoscopic surgeons as we said earlier. let's quickly look at the indications of anterior reflux surgery, and those patients who are unwilling for long-term PPIs, those who are the non-responders, and those who are side effects, and those who have large hiatus hernias. I'm also very interested in this complex group of patients who has complicated GERD or present with atypical GERD symptoms. For the youngsters in the audience, a large hiatus hernia is not an indication of surgery. You may have a large hiatus hernia and well into reflux. On the other hand, you may just have a vaginal G junction which causes a severe reflux. So in your career in life, I always tell my fellows and residents who train with me, is the famous Latin adage of sitius, altius, fortius. Try and do better every year on what you did in your career. I've asked the postgraduates here to read this book by Atul Gawande, an Indian-American who put out what is called a checklist manifesto. A wonderful book on analyzing whatever little topic you do, and I think this can be applied to every form of surgery, be it a cholecystectomy, robotic AR, or anti-reflux surgery. So which patients, in our experience, do not do well? And there is enough data to show that male patients, those who are volume refluxers, and those who respond to PPI, are probably the best patients who do well in surgery. A redo surgery like this is not only technically complex, but also may not produce the best results of surgery. Impedance pH, look at lifestyle, look at compliance, double the dose of PPI, and then only consider surgery. There is data to show that anti-reflux surgery in carefully chosen patients with refractory GERD may actually help. I often get asked this very basic question in practice: when do you do the manometry and when do you do a 24-hour pH? I think there are two different indications. A 24-hour pH is basically meant to diagnose GERD. So we have a patient who has atypical symptoms, be it retrosternal chest pain, jaw pain, laryngitis, asthma, then only we do a routine 24-hour pH. But in our center, we do an impedance manometry in every patient, because we can rule out or speed out patients where surgery will not benefit, and this reflects in the SAGES guidelines. As a surgeon, you need to look at all available options: anterior fund application, posterior fund application, and the various types of posterior fund applications. If you look at the data, the toupees or the partial fund application has a lesser dysphagia, but has equally good anti-reflux control. We however know that the Nissen's is a far more durable operation. So in the younger patients, I will go in for Nissen's, and I'll talk about this after we discuss the technical aspects of this operation. This is the typical position of a patient. The patient is put, this is a typical anti-reflux patient, split leg position. I'm standing between the patient's legs. The monitor is about the left shoulder of the patient. It's actually a very simple operation. I teach my fellows that you divide an operation into steps. Be it a circumcision or a CAPG, in your mind you will categorize the operation in different steps. And the first step of this operation is to identify the right crus. The pars placida is open, the right crus is identified, then the left crus is identified, then a retroistial window is made. Now you can see there is very minimally edited to do this operation. And if you divide your operation in steps, you can really go wrong. The only time you make exception to this is when there is a pathology in the patient or an anatomical abnormality that makes you change your strategy. This is the right crus, this is the left crus. You can dissect very easily. And the operation I'm doing today is very different from the operation I did 10 years ago. They never actually went into the posterior mediastinum or the spine. I now believe that one of the most important steps to getting successful anti-reflux surgery is to lengthen the esophagus. And I would go to the extent of measuring the length of the esophagus in the abdomen. You can see I'm working in the posterior mediastinum, making a large lateral window. And this is a loose areolar plane. The only thing to worry about is the posterior vagus. Once you see the posterior vagus, there is really nothing of interest here. You can safely divide almost up to the inferior pulmonary vessels. We're very used to doing trans-hiatal esophagectomies laparoscopically. And this is an area of anatomy which we are very familiar with. We actually will put on a tape to measure that we have got 5 centimeters of esophagus in the abdomen. So lengthening the esophagus in the posterior mediastinum is something that we underdo, and that's an important cause of rat migration and complication and failure of reflux surgery. Then find, we will discuss all these points individually about Shushai maneuvers, about short gastrics, and This is basically how we are. This is what is called a shoeshine maneuver. And then this is the tool rip. A little one technical tip is you never remove the peritoneum on the right crus. If you have a wide defect, sometimes you'll find the whole right crus sticks on the table, and then you will have difficulty in closing this. We are routinely switched over from using polypropylene, using ethibond, which is polyfilament, non-absorbable, and a much easier switch material to use as compared to. Another important point is to mark the OT junction using a Penrose nail or a Foley catheter. Important, the anti-reflux wrap must be only 2.5 centimeters. The longer the wrap, the lesser the anti-reflux problem. It should not be below 2 centimeters, and it should certainly not be more than 3 centimeters doing this. And this is how the wrap is performed using Mercil or Ethibond. So there are two types of esophageal mobilization I'm going to talk about, but two problems we face. Sometimes mobilizing the mass placida, you will see an anomalous left hepatic that comes off the celiac. So if you see a large artery crossing the mass placida in this area, you will clip the vessel, wait for about 10 minutes to see congestion of the liver, and then proceed. The second is injuries to the left pleura. Now I have injured pleura about 10 times, mostly in patients of recurrent fundoplication where the wrap is migrated. The technical tip I may give you is if you make a small hole in the pleura, convert it into a big hole. The CO2 will get pushed out very easily, and I, in my career of the last 20 years, placed an intercostal drain only once in my career. Every other time with a good peep, the lung will expand and push in the CO2 in the chest. So these are important technical tips as you're doing this. The most important thing we need to avoid is anti-reflux efficacy and a post-operative dysphagia must be reported. So how do you decide the kind of wrap? This is our criteria. We will actually do a distance fundoplication for a young patient who has normal esophageal length and has a large hiatus. On the other hand, if you have a slightly shortened esophagus which you need to mobilize, if you have an elderly patient, the oldest patient I have operated is 72-year-old classical singular. And the lady would tell me that every time during halab she would have food coming in the mouth. So I go and look at the biological age rather than looking at the comorbidities. And then I would do a two-phase fundoplication, which has a lower dysphagia rate, but probably is less durable. What about the door fundoplication? Technically an easier operation to perform, but the door clearly has less dysphagia, but has a lower anti-reflux property as compared to this. And the only time we do the door is when we're doing a cardiomyotomy to cover this. And this is how, that two ways of doing the door. I'm showing you the classic door, where the stomach is sutured to the lateral edge of the esophagus with 3 sutures, and then a further 2 sutures are taken on the left crus. What it basically does is accentuates the angle of S. We then take the greater curve and suture it to the right crus to cover the esophagus completely to do an anti-reflux property. So remember, the door must remain a prophylactic operation, not an operation for a crude reflux. Its efficacy is less than all posterior fundoplications, though the dysphagia rates are naturally lower. Some technical tips I want to discuss. I am a believer in mobilizing the stomach well. We easily say we'll do a full and floppy distance, but we understand the meaning of these words. To give you a floppy distance, remember the stomach is anchored to the pancreas. This is one of my old videos, you take a 10 mm of money. This is the pancreas, this is where the spleen vessel is running. But remember, it's not only the short gastrics. There's a pain.
आज हैदराबाद में शादान मेडिकल कॉलेज और डॉक्टर वीआरके वुमेंस मेडिकल कॉलेज में सर्जनों का कॉन्फ्रेंस हम कर रहे हैं। ये हर साल कहीं ना कहीं तेलंगाना में या तो आंध्रा में होते रहता, तो इस साल हम शादान मेडिकल कॉलेज और वीआरके वुमेंस मेडिकल कॉलेज में एक कॉन्फ्रेंस कर रहे हैं। ये कॉन्फ्रेंस का मेन मकसद यह है कि सर्जरीज़ दिन ब दिन एडवांस होते जा रहे हैं, टेक्निक एडवांस होते जा रहे हैं, और किस तरह से एडवांसमेंट एक कॉमन मैन के लिए सहूलत हो सकती है, इसके बारे में डिस्कशंस करने के लिए हर साल एक थीम लेके हम कॉन्फ्रेंस बनाते हैं। तो इस टाइम की कॉन्फ्रेंस ये थीम लेके बना रहे हैं। अब आजकल लैप्रोस्कोपिक सर्जरी आ गया, रोबोटिक सर्जरीज आ गए, लेजर्स आ गए, ये किस तरह से एक कॉमन मैन के लिए हेल्पफुल हो सकते हैं, और इसके वजह से कॉस्ट बढ़ रहा है क्या, अगर कॉस्ट को कैसा कम कर सकते हैं, क्या कर सकते हैं, ये सब डिस्कशन करने के लिए सर्जिकल कॉन्फ्रेंस में हम काफ़ी पैनल डिस्कशंस रखे और पेपर प्रेजेंटेशंस रखे, और इसके साथ ओरेशंस भी है। हमारे तेलंगाना के काफ़ी फेमस सर्जन जो गुजर गए, डॉक्टर ए के चारी साहब, डॉक्टर जी पी रामैया साहब, जो गुज़िश्ता साल के बहुत बड़े सर्जन थे, वो हमारे लिए पूरे हमारे उस्ताद थे, तो उनके नाम पे ओरेशंस भी रख लिए सब। तो बाहर के स्टेट से हम स्पीकर्स को बुलाए, वो अपने तजुर्बा हमसे शेयर कर रहे हैं सब। इस तरह से सब एक सर्जिकल फ्रेटर्निटी, एक ख़ानदान के ऐसा, एक फैमिली के ऐसा मिल के हर किसी के बारे में डिस्कस कर लेके और इसके इम्प्रेशंस लेके वो प्रैक्टिस करने के काबिल हो जाते हैं सब। सो दिस इज़ द पर्पस ऑफ दिस पर्टिकुलर कॉन्फ्रेंस। दिस कॉन्फ्रेंस इज़ बेसिकली मेंट फॉर द सर्जन्स टू अपग्रेड देयर नॉलेज इन सर्जरी। द सर्जरी इज सच ए फास्ट ग्रोइंग सब्जेक्ट with the latest additions like laser, the laparoscopy and the robotics, how it's going to help a common man? Is it going to be a burden for the common man or is it going to be a boon to the common man? How best we can help the common man with advancing technologies? And this is every year conference. This time we are organizing the Shahdan and Dr. B.R.K. Women's Medical College. About 500 delegates have registered and they are all participating in various deliberations. And the most important part of the conference is we have got three orations named after great surgeons, two surgeons who have already left this world, but they left the name, Dr. A.K. Chari and Dr. G.P. Ramaya, and Dr. Bura Narsegaud, he has given endowment oration. So all these things will add up to the knowledge of the young surgeon, and he gets enriched by the knowledge, and by the time he goes out, he'll be in a position to practice surgery much better. So that's the aim of this particular conference.
Sir, jo robotic surgery hai, aur laparoscopic surgery hai, अगर कोई सर्जन एक्सपर्टीज हासिल कर लेता है तो क्या नॉलेज शेयरिंग के अलावा ट्रेनिंग सेशंस भी होते हैं दूसरे?
बिल्कुल, कल वीआरके वुमेन्स मेडिकल कॉलेज में इसका एक वर्कशॉप कंडक्ट करें हम, तो कम से कम एक 75 पोस्ट ग्रेजुएट्स आके उसका ट्रेनिंग लिए समझो। ये दिन हर रोज़ प्रैक्टिस करने की ट्रेनिंग है, एक दिन ट्रेनिंग लेने से ये ख़त्म नहीं होती। इसमें ट्रेनिंग करने के बाद उसके एग्ज़ाम्स होते, एग्ज़ाम्स में पास होने के बाद ही वो टाइप ऑफ सर्जरी करने का उनको कॉन्फिडेंस आता और परमिशन मिलता सब।
सर, एट प्रेजेंट लेपारोस्कोपिक सर्जरी तो बहुत पुरानी है, उसका सक्सेस रेट कितना है?
आजकल थोड़े सर्जिकल प्रोसीजर्स जो है ना, ऑलमोस्ट 100% लेपारोस्कोपी से ही कर रहे हैं। जैसा गॉल ब्लैडर सर्जरी है और आपके यूट्रस हिस्टेक्टमीज है, पेट के अंदर के जो एडिशंस वगैरह जो है उसके लिए पूरा दे आर डूइंग लेपारोस्कोपिक सर्जरीज कर रहे हैं सब। रोबोटिक सर्जरीज की अभी उतना डिफाइन नहीं हुआ, थोड़े एरियाज पे रोबोटिक सर्जरी बेटर देन लैप्रोस्कोपिक सर्जरी है, लेकिन वो कॉस्ट इफेक्टिव नहीं है अभी। अच्छा। तो आगे बढ़ने के बाद वो कॉस्ट में कम होने से रोबोटिक सर्जरी भी कॉमन होने के चांसेस है।
आमतौर पे लोग ये डरते हैं कि लैप्रोस्कोपिक सर्जरी में चूँकि एकदम की होल रहता है, सारा कैमरे पर देखकर किया जाता है, तो एक्सीडेंटल कटिंग ऑफ इंपॉर्टेंट आर्टरीज एंड ऑल दैट, ऐसा होता है?
नहीं, इसके लिए ट्रेनिंग होना ज़रूरी है। जैसा पहली दफ़ा जब साइकिल चलाते वक्त बच्चा डरता कि साइकिल का टक्कर मारता होगा, जब उन्हें परफेक्ट होने के बाद साइकिल ऑटोमेटिकली चलती, वैसे ही गाड़ी की ड्राइविंग भी, पहले टक्कर मारता होगा तो डर लगता, फिर उसके बाद ऑटोमेटिकली उन्हें रेक्टिफाई हो जाता। तो इंस्पाइट ऑफ ट्रेनिंग होने पर भी कभी कभी हादसे होने के चांसेस रहते, लेकिन वो हादसे को कैसा रोक सकते हुए तो कैसा उसको ट्रीट कर सकते, ये एक कॉन्फ्रेंसेस में वो डिस्कस होता है। तो दिस इज़ ऑल्सो पार्ट ऑफ आवर ट्रेनिंग।
आपने दूसरा सवाल का भी जवाब दे दिया, बहुत शुक्रिया।